My dear student, I am Dr. S. Karmakar, Chief Scientist, Department of Agronomy. Today, I will be discussing Rabi pulses, which is a part of your crop production technology too, that is Rabi crops, for the basic agriculture 4 semester batches. You know the course content, I will discuss about origin, geographical distribution, soil and climatic characteristics, varieties, cultural practices and yield of three major Rabi pulses, that is chickpea, field pea and lentil. Now you may ask why we should grow pulses, because you know that it is very very important crop. Pulses are very nutritionally rich, particularly it is rich in amino acids, calcium, phosphorus and other nutrients, as well as some medicinal value also. It is very much tolerant to moisture stress condition, and you know it is actually, it supplies food to human community, it supplies food to animal community, as well as it enriches soil. You know, it increases soil fertility with addition to nitrogen. Chickpea around 120 to 140 kg per hectare, it fixes in the soil. Similarly, pigeon pea also 80 to 120 kg per hectare, and mung bean 112 kg per hectare. And in addition to that, it also added huge amount of organic matter to the soil, which is the life of the soil, which will help to increase water holding, water use efficiency, nutrient use efficiency, as well as it increases microbial population. And also it is very relatively, it is cheaper as compared to other protein rich foods. And also it is very easier to transport and storing of these protein rich food items. And it also wider acceptability also. So we must grow pulses to enrich our soil, to enrich human community as well as animal community. Now you know chickpea, actually it is also known as Bengal gram. You may say chana, then chole. So many terms are there in different languages. And its scientific name, you know, Sesar arietinum, and leguminosity is Fabaceae, which is also known as leguminosity. And its chromosome number is 2N is equal to 16. Do you know why it is called chickpea? Because its seed is spherical in shape, wrinkled as well as smooth, with a pointed beak, and which resembles of a chicken's head, just like chicken head with a pointed beak. That is why it is called as chickpea. Now coming to its origin and history. Bengal gram is believed to have originated somewhere in Southwest Asia, preferably in Afghanistan and Iran, which was earlier known as Persia. According to Aykroyd and Doughty, 1964, the origin is Eastern Mediterranean. And according to De Condol, it is India is the origin of chickpea, because it is mentioned in Sanskrit language. So it is mainly cultivated in world scenario, where India ranks first, then Australia, Myanmar, then Ethiopia, then Turkey, Pakistan, USA, and also Africa. If you see in Indian condition, different states are there. First Madhya Pradesh comes rank first in India with regards to area as well as production. And then comes Maharashtra, then Rajasthan, then Karnataka, then Uttar Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, also Bihar as well as Jharkhand. Now I am coming status of total pulse production in different countries. You can see the data. India ranks first. The area coverage is 30.85 million hectare, which covers around 35.4% of India. And then production is 18.15 million ton, which shares in 21.7% of India. But yield is very low as compared to this world scenario, because you may see that 958 is the average production. Total area is 87 million hectare, and total production is 83.46. And then comes Canada, second ranks, with regards to its production, that is 8.13 million tons. Then Myanmar, and then comes China, USA. And if you see the productivity, USA ranks first, 2,034 kg per hectare it yields. And then Myanmar, it also received good yield, that is 2,100 kg per hectare. Now coming to the status of chickpea production in different states. As I told earlier, Madhya Pradesh ranked first, 3.59 million hectare, with a production of 4.6 million ton. And also its yield is 1280 kg per hectare, which is highest productivity in India. And Maharashtra, then Rajasthan, then Karnataka, Uttar Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Jharkhand, you see the area is very less, 0.23 million hectare, and with a production of 0.29 million hectare. And see, the productivity is very good. It ranks second. All India average is yield is 1063 kg per hectare, which was earlier during 1950-51, it was only 482 kg per hectare. Now coming to climatic requirement, an annual rainfall of 60 to 100 centimeter is good enough for chickpea production. Being winter season legume, it requires dry and cool climate. It prefers around 22 to 25 degrees centigrade during its germination, and then moderately low temperature, that is 15 to 18 degrees centigrade at the time of flowering and fruiting. Excessive rainfall during sowing or flowering or fruiting damages the crop heavily. Of course, hailstorm also causes very severe damage in yield. However, it very good responds 2-3 irrigation, light irrigation during its branching and its pod development. And during flowering or fruiting time, high humidity associated with cloudy weather, it invites spreading of fungal disease. Now have a look on botany of chickpea. Its stem are branched. Primary branches may vary 1 to 8, and it covered fully granular here. If you see its leaf is pinnately compound, and it also covered with glandular hairs. Its petal is purple in color and contain anthocyanin pigment. It reaches maximum height you can see 45 to 60 centimeter. And you might have seen full grown chickpea. This is just diagrammatic figure, and its root system is very deep, and nodulated also. So 30 to 50, 60 nodules are found in the roots. Its economic importance. You know that it is used as dal, as well as chole, sweet, and other many attractive dishes. Also, wetted or dried, this chickpea is used for consumption. Then, its straw is excellent fodder, and beets of cotyledon also used as valuable cattle feed. And you also know that in Jharkhand and Chhattisgarh and Madhya Pradesh, there is a leafy vegetable. It is leaf, its leaf is very much tasty for leafy vegetables, which is known as saag. So, its if you see its nutritive value, protein content ranges 18 to 22%, carbohydrate 61 to 62%, fat 4.5, phosphorus 280 mg/100 g, and then iron 12.3 mg/100 g, and calcium 301 mg/100 g, and also energy that is around 400 kilocalorie per 100 gram. Its leaf also consists of malic and citric acid, which has very good medicinal value. It is actually used for stomach ailment and blood purifier. Then coming to classification, it has a chickpea. Generally, two types of chickpea we found. One is the desi chickpea, that is known as brown chickpea, and another is white, which is in color, that is kabuli chickpea. Desi chickpea is known as Sisar arietinum, and kabuli chickpea is Sisar kabulium. And by the color, you can differentiate. Seed coat color in desi chickpea is yellowish to brown, and in case of kabuli chickpea, it is white in color. Its seed is bold and very attractive. It has desi chickpea has good branching habit, but in case of kabuli chickpea, it is poor in branching. Then desi chickpea contains anthocyanin pigment, but this kabuli chickpea is lacking of anthocyanin pigment. Its seed size of desi chickpea is very small, and in case of kabuli chickpea, it is bigger, and which is generally more than 25 gram per 100 seed. Then its petal of desi chickpea is purple in color, and in case of white chickpea, it is white. Most important thing is, in case of desi chickpea, it is widely cultivated. Desi chickpea, around 90% of total chickpea is desi chickpea, and this is why kabuli chickpea is very less cultivated. Now, coming to soil, it can be grown very wide range of soil, just sandy loam to clay loam in northern India, whereas in case of central and southern India, black cotton soil is very preferable for this chickpea. And then it prefers mainly clay loam with good drainage facility and neutral pH. Land preparation, if you say, then it needs cloddy. Very clod, because it is very much sensitive to soil aeration. It needs clodded and rough seed bed for better aeration, which can be achieved by one, deep plowing, followed by two, harrowing. Fine tilt and compact, very fine soil is not good for chickpea cultivation. In the other lands, one plowing by desi plow is good enough for chickpea sowing. What I am telling, it's all suitable for desi chickpea. But in case of kabuli chickpea, very fine tilth is required because the seed size of kabuli chickpea is larger than desi chickpea. So seed imbibition for its germination required high moisture. So soil contact should be there in case of chickpea. Besides, chickpea seed coat is very soft. So in cloddy soil, it damages the skin of kabuli chickpea. For that reason, for kabuli chickpea cultivation, fine tilth, just like wheat land preparation, is required. Then coming to seed and sowing. Normal sowing time is second fortnight of October to first fortnight of November. For peninsular India, first fortnight of October is the best time. Early, that does not mean early sowing always better for any for chickpea production. It is not that. You have to go through the history as well as climatic condition. And sometimes early sowing may suffer from wind going to high temperature at that time. So we must care where wilt are prevailing disease, their late sowing is required. If about spacing, it requires 30 to 45 centimeter row to row. In case of desi chickpea, it requires 30 centimeter. In case of kabuli chickpea, it requires 45 centimeter row to row. And plant to plant, in both the cases, 10 centimeter is good enough. Then coming to seed rate. In case of desi chickpea, seed rate 70 to 80 kg is enough. But in case of kabuli chickpea, 90 to 100 kg seed rate is used. And before sowing, you should go for seed treatment. Control the damage due to wilt and dry root rot, you have to treat the seed with phytohex or tebuconazole with 2 gram per kg seed. In areas where termites are expected, then seeds should be treated with chlorpyrifos 5 to 8 ml per kg of seed. Actually, in case of kabuli chickpea, seed size is larger, so higher amount at around 8 ml is required to treat the seed with chlorpyrifos. I told you seed treatment is required and you have to go for a FIR system. That means previously we have treated the seed with fungicide, then insecticide, that is chlorpyrifos. Then lastly, you have to treat with microbes, rhizobium. Seed treatment is necessary for pulse production and you should not forget it. For that reason, one packet of rhizobium is enough to treat the seed which is required for half acre. And for that reason, you have to take 100 gram jaggery or gur in 500 ml liter of water. Then you have to boil the solution and then let it cool. You have to, after cooling of solution, you have to add the rhizobium. Then you have to mix rhizobium in the solution properly with the help of a stick for good mixing. Then this mixture must be poured on a bucket which is containing the seed. Then you have to mix the seed so that a good layer comes on the surface of the seed. And then you have to allow the seed for drying in cooler place. So it is suggested that one day before sowing, seed treatment should be done in the evening hours. Now coming to manures and fertilizers. You know the chickpea is a leguminous crop, so it fixes nitrogen as I discussed earlier. So nitrogen part is fulfilled, but starter dose you have to give. That is 20 to 25 kg per hectare is good enough nitrogen. And then you have to, it is very much sensitive to phosphorus, so you have to give the 40 to 50 kg P2O5, then 20 to 25 kg K2O and 20 kg sulfur per hectare should be applied. In acidic soil, 3 to 4 quintal lime should be applied on the furrow just before sowing. And it is always suggested that any addition of any organic matter, that is FOM or compost, at the rate of 5 ton certainly increases its yield. And chemical fertilizer should be placed around 7 to 10 centimeter below the soil, just before you have to apply this fertilizer, just before sowing of seed. And then for special management, for increasing higher yield, if you apply 2% urea or NPK spray at the time of flowering as well as pod development, certainly it improves its yield around 15 to 20%. Now coming to varieties, you know, I think you studied in that internal factors, varieties has a great role to increase productivity. Whatever I discussed, that was external factors. Now coming to this internal factors, that is varieties, this Avaradhi, Gaurav, JG315, then Annagiri, now I am coming to varieties. It has great role. You have studied in the first semester that internal factors like variety has a great role to improve its yield. So this variety, which is actually resistant to disease as well as insect, will give better yield. And these are old varieties: Avrodhi, Gaurav, JG315, Annagiri 1. These are old varieties, still I have given here, because we will find this in most of the books. These varieties are prevalent and it is also very promising, and still somewhere it is continuing. And in our Jharkhand, Birsa Chana 3 and then JG14, these are two types of Desi chickpea, and HK4 is Kabuli chickpea. These are a recent variety. And old varieties also are still existing, that is Pantgram 114, KWR 108, KPG 59, these are Desi, and Kak 2 as well as Seta ICCV2, these are Kabuli chickpea, grows well in Jharkhand. These are some recent varieties released after 2010, that is RBG 203. It is moderately resistant to wilt and dry root rot. Its duration is 100. And then PBG5, it is long duration and 160 to 65 days, resistant to Ascoblighta disease. And then GJG0809, GNG1958, GNG1969, these are around 5 months duration, and yield is good, that is 20 to 25 kg yield you can harvest. And then CSG515, its duration is 4.5 months, that is 135 days. And then GLK, it is around five months, and it is suitable for irrigated area. It is a large seeded variety. And this another variety, that is mostly Kabuli variety, and the duration is very less, that is PKV Kabuli 4, it is only 100 to 110 days. Then Gujarat Junagadh Gram 3, it is also 100 days. GPF 2, it is little bit longer duration, that is 134 to 163. And then again MNK 1, 95 to 110 days. Raj Vijay Kabuli Gram 101, it is 90 to 110 days. Then Raj Vijay Gram 201, It is also 95 to 113 days. HK4, that is 136 days. And then Raj Vijay Kavali Gram 202, that is only 105 days duration and suitable for very late condition. Now coming to weed management. Actually, it is very much sensitive during early growth. It cannot compete with the weeds. So during early stage, between 25 to 30 days, it should be field should be weeded for better growth of the plant. Then next weeding should be done around 50 to 55 days after sowing. Certainly manual weeding is better than chemical weeding, because you know that it is nodulated root system is there, and rhizobium is aerobic. So if soil compaction is there, that means growth of nodule, growth of rhizobium will be hampered. So nitrogen fixation and will not be there. So loosening of soil certainly will help the growth of rhizobium. So manual weeding, both way, it will loosen the soil, means improve aeration, as well as clean the weeds. And if you go for chemical weeding, then pre-emergence application of pendimethalin, 3 liter per hectare, should be applied. Just as pre-emergence, that means just after sowing, 2 to 3 days, within 2 to 3 days, it should be applied. And then another herbicide is imidazopyr. That should be applied within 20 to 25 days after sowing as post-emergence herbicide. If you go for integrated herbicide management, then it will be better. That means you have to apply pendimethalin at the rate of 3 liter per hectare, and then one hand weeding at 30 to 35 days after sowing. Another promising herbicide came in this present time, that is Velor. It is a ready mix herbicide, pendimethalin and imidazopyr, and which can be applied at the time of just after sowing as pre-emergence herbicide. Now coming to water management. Actually, it is mostly sown as rain-fed crop. Still, it needs during, because two main critical stages are there, egg branching and another is flowering or pod development. So too light irrigation at the time of branching, as well as pod development, is required for higher yield. And one, actually, in case of moisture stress condition, just at the time of sowing, your light irrigation will be helpful for better germination. And you must remember that in case of Kabuli chickpea, irrigation should be provided before sowing of the crop, then crop should be sown. But in case of desi chickpea, after sowing, irrigation can be provided. Because soil, in case of compaction of soil, desi chickpea is strong enough to come out from the soil, but desi Kabuli chickpea is very weak to come out after emergence. So after irrigation, there will be compaction of soil. So in case of Kabuli chickpea, you should apply irrigation just before sowing, then sowing of crops should be done. Now coming to major pests of chickpea, three major insects like gram pod borer, Helicoverpa armigera, cutworm Agrotis ypsilon, and then termite Odontotermes obesus. These three major pests damages chickpea. Termites, it bores into the root system and stem also, and kills the plant. It also attack in standing crop during drought period. So its control is very important for sanitization of field. Timely disposal of crops stubble should be done, and undecomposed FOM should not be used. 2 to 3 deep plowing is required to control the termite damage. You have to destroy the termite heap around the field, and you should kill the queen. Then its incidence will be less. And then another thing, you may treat the seed with chlorpyrifos, 8 to 10 ml per kg of seed. Also control the termite attack. And after in the standing crop, chlorpyrifos can be used as spray. Coming to gram pod borer, actually symptoms is skeletonization of leaves, feeding chlorophyll only leaving the veins. In green pods, make a circular hole and it feed the grain, make empty. So its management is very important. Have to keep pheromone trap, 12 number per hectare, and then bud perch, 50 number per hectare is required. Indoxacarb or spinosad at the rate of 5.5 liter per hectare, spraying during the attack of gram podar, it will be helpful. And then neem kernel seed extract 5% along after, followed by quinol phos 1.5 liter per hectare, is also helpful to control gram pod borer. Neem oil spray at the rate of 12.5 liter per hectare is also helpful to control gram pod borer. Then coming to cutworm, its symptom is caterpillar remains in the soil at a depth of 2 to 4 inches. It cut the tender plants at the base, and then caterpillar drag the cut parts into soil for feeding. Management, deep summer plowing is required. Then well decomposed FOM or compost should be applied. Adapt crop rotation. Intercropping with wheat, linseed, etc. will be helpful to check the cutworm attack. And then spray insecticide like Spark, and then quinol phos at the rate of 1 liter per hectare can control cutworm attack. Now coming to the soil borne disease, Fusarium wilt, that is a causal organism is Fusarium oxysporum, dry root rot, Rhizoctonia batatiacola, then collar rot, Sclerotium rolfsi. These are the main soil borne disease in case of chicken. What is the symptoms of collar rot? That is, early sown crops are prone to be affected more. The disease is confined at seedling stage only. The pathogen caused significant reduction in plant population. And in case of Fusarium wilt, the symptom is dead seedlings or plant, usually you will see in patches. Then disease can be observed within 2 weeks of sowing. That means early stage its attack is there, Fusarium wilt you will find. Then seedling collapse and lie flat on the ground with dull green color. These are the symptoms of collar rot as well as Fusarium wilt. Both these diseases can be controlled, that we manage, avoid. You have to avoid sowing when temperature is high. You have to go for crop rotation. Then growing of resistant variety and disease free, it will help to check this disease. And seed treatment with tebuconazole, that is Folicar, at the rate of 1 ml per kg seed, also check these two diseases, collar rot as well as Fusarium wilt. And now coming to foliar disease, this is common disease is Ascochyta blight. And these are the symptoms. You see the some black patches is there. The emerging seedlings develop dark brown lesion at the base of the stem. Affected seedling will die, and fully developed lesion on pod usually round with concentric rig. Management is sowing late or deep sowing. Intercultural intercropping should be done with this wheat, barley, mustard, etc. And seed treatment is also helpful to check this disease, that is tebuconazole 1 ml per kg seed. Our foliar application of Bordeaux mixture or wettable sulfur is also helpful to control this ascochyta blight. Now coming to rust disease. It appears mainly on the leaves. It is small, round, powdery pustules, and these pustules tends to coalesce. And severely infected crop looks rusty and plants may dry up prematurely. Its control is spray propiconazole, that is called DIL, at the rate of 0.1%. So we have to take with this measure, then disease-free crop can give better yield. Otherwise, you have to sacrifice around 20 to 25% yield. This is it is also an important. You have to be ready at the stage of physiological maturity of the crop. And nowadays, some ground clearance from varieties are there. Their ground clearance is there, and mechanized harvesting is possible in those varieties. So in this way, you can go for mechanized harvesting, and then you have to clean the thrashed grain. And for manual, you have to just for pulling whole plant or cutting at the base level, then you have to dry it, then it should be trampled by the bullock, and then it should be cleaned, and it should be stored when the moisture content does not exceed 10 to 12%. Otherwise, in case in storing, brookid insect will damage the grains. And this is all about the chickpea production. So thank you very much.